Sometimes it's hard to see the great pine in the seedling. Or the champion in the boy.
I've taken some chances, and I sometimes have been right, and sometimes I've been wrong.
Or the dream inside a man standing in a crowded city council chambers in the waning hours of a cool spring night that inside is heating up considerably.
I'm not trying to pat myself on the back, I'm just stating facts, and I've turned down enormous amounts of money for this deal. I am committing $45 million to this deal. And yet the question continues to be asked, what is to stop Larry Miller from taking the Jazz and leaving if we put our $20 million in? I have to tell you that I do get offended when people keep raising the question because I've shown my colors on that deal. I can move Karl Malone and John Stockton, I can't move an arena. And that $45 million is sitting there and I'm committed to it. We have before us an opportunity to do something very special that will affect our community and state in a positive way for 30 to 50 years. Respectfully, Larry H. Miller.
It is where this story begins, with a man who feels more at home talking about pistons and plugs than planning and zoning. In a city still attached to the sandstone cylinder that is home for the modest successes of another era. This is the story of a community and a bond forged by the challenge of what many said couldn't be done.
Every few weeks, there's a new rumor that has flown about the team being sold or about the financing not working. And I know it has been very frustrating for Larry. Anyone who doubted his ability and his commitment more than anything else to getting this done forgot what he went through to buy the team.
But the doubts were real. 1 year after local government pledged 10 acres and $20 million for a site to build a new sports complex, there was still no money for the arena itself. Courting potential lenders was a frustrating year-long journey of ups and downs that finally ended with a unique partnership.
We are extremely pleased being able to announce that effective day before yesterday, we finalized terms with Sumitomo Trust to finance our new arena.
With a $66 million agreement in tow, the community is anxious to jump aboard.
We're ready. We've been waiting for this day. We're very excited, and we're very enthused. And I want to express to you, Larry, our commitment that you'll have our cooperation, and we will be putting together our best team to make sure that this arena happens in the time frame that it needs to.
Larry, we're proud of you. You know, it's said that hard things take a little time, the impossible take a little longer. This one's taken a little longer than you hoped it would take, but you've done what many people, I think, felt was impossible.
The impossible in this case turned out to be simply another step. To get the financing, Miller agreed to have the arena completed in time for the 1991 basketball and hockey seasons, just 16 months away. That's plenty of time to build a fast food restaurant, but for a 20,000-seat sports complex, it was simply unheard of. Just coming up with the blueprints for such a job would take over a year, and at that moment, the only thing on paper were the artist's conceptions. If the schedule was to be met, there was only one way to meet it.
Fast track,
fast track,
fast track.
Fast track is where the owner's conception of the building and the architect's design and the engineer's design and calculations and the construction of the building all occur at the same time.
George Hansen represents in part Larry Miller's commitment to make this a Utah job done with Utah talent. The Salt Lake architectural firm of FFKR is chosen by Miller to put the design on paper. The construction would be a joint venture between Sahara Construction of Bountiful, Utah, and Japan's Obayashi Corporation. The team is now in place.
We'd like to get the activity started.
As dignitaries gather to break the ground that only 500 days hence is supposed to be a massive sports arena, it seemed only appropriate that the Master of Ceremonies deliver greetings of support from faraway places.
Sorry I cannot be with you, but I have been detained in New York. Please give my best to all my friends in Salt Lake City, and if you should need more money, please do not hesitate to call. And it's signed, Adnan Khashoggi.
Against the backdrop of frivolity, ceremony, and spectacle, those who had the most to risk sounded an encouraging call for the uncertain days to come.
Today's groundbreaking for a new sports arena in New York City is the result of months of hard work. Real challenge, however, lies ahead of us.
We invite you all to use this arena to put it to work upon its completion so that it may truly fill the measure of its creation, that being to make the state of Utah and the city of Salt Lake an even better place to live and to work and to play.
There is nothing magic about it. You pick a corner and dig clockwise, deep enough to pour concrete footings, then columns and walls. By the time you pour the first level floor and the start corner, the finish corner is still being excavated. You literally chase yourself around the hole, hoping all the time the architects can stay at least one step ahead of you. In fast-track construction, there are two constants, pressure and change. Adjustments from the designers can come to the site hourly.
We moved a kitchen from the first floor to the second floor, and structurally we have to block out for floor sinks, you know, plumbing and electrical conduits and that. What becomes a challenge is coordinating all of that just prior to placing the concrete. And typically it winds up down to the hour. I mean, an hour, 2 hours before you place concrete on the deck, you're making slight changes to accommodate those people at a later date.
You wake up at night and you think about things you should have done. You think about problems that could happen, and you have the most incredible nightmares you've ever can imagine.
Just 10 weeks after the excavation begins, the three tower cranes are up, and parts of the third floor are taking shape. It is hot, and 12-hour shifts make it seem hotter, but it's paying off.
Crane operator on tower crane number 2 has been flying gang forms all day, and I reckon he's getting a little itchy. He's been sitting up there for about 10 hours now.
Because much of the interior will be exposed concrete, concrete forms are meticulously puttied and sanded to achieve a paper-smooth finish. There are 90,000 cubic yards of concrete going into the arena site, enough to pour a sidewalk from Salt Lake to Las Vegas. Nearly 8 million pounds of reinforcement iron is tied precisely into the formed walls, columns, and floors. It is tedious, but critical work. There are no shortcuts.
You guys should be asking me questions rather than me asking you, probably. But
a few blocks from the site, weekly coordinating meetings are crucial. The smallest of issues are hammered out by the contractors, architects, and engineers. Miller, who frequently joins the meeting, shows an uncanny understanding of detail and a touch for mediation.
Well, but there's no reason for that to be 8, because the inside one needs to be 8 because you've got to run stuff in it. You don't want to run stuff in it. It could be 6.
To resolve the conflict, let's document it and say, here's what we'd like to have, where are you today, and what would it cost to change it?
Well, let me ask a question. Did they work off a baseline document that showed 9?
At some point in time, apparently we had a fee, I think. I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you one thing for sure, 5.11 doesn't work.
Well, like you said, I think you need to sketch out what you want, then we'll go back and try to make sure we understand totally what we've got in our estimate, because we worked off some fairly old drawings.
So if it was 9 that you worked off of originally, I think we should have 9 or talk about it.
May.
So let's find out. It's an open item, so let's find out, okay?
There are 200 workers on the job now, most of them Utahs, all of them stockholders in a challenge that has forged a new spirit of cooperation. The weather is holding, the construction is on schedule, and momentum building. But now the summer is over, and the winter becomes a critical unknown that prompts an even greater resolve. To say the arena was built in less than 500 days is true only if you include 500 nights. While the city sleeps, work goes on under the glow of portable lights. The demands of schedule require it. Iron workers tie steel and buckle up forms so concrete can flow on the day shift. Construction moves at such a rapid pace that leaving town for just a few days means coming home to a different structure. December in Utah is enchanting. Lights, music, the greatest snow on earth. Over at the Salt Palace, the Jazz are enjoying one of their hottest runs of the season. And tonight, a warm chair in the palace must seem like a bit of heaven for those working into the night a block away. It is cold. A record chill during the last week of December keeps temperatures below zero. Conditions are miserable. Cold bodies work slowly. Fresh concrete will freeze, then chip and crack. For two precious weeks, the project is at a standstill. Begins with a cold reality that the nation is going to war. On site, there is lost time to make up for, but the hearts and minds of everyone are with family, friends, and countrymen putting it all on the line, a half a world away. January, it will be said, gave pause for perspective. Even so, the work goes on.
When we first started out, we were working pretty much around the clock. Right now, our people are working typically 6 days a week, 10 hours a day. We've got about 145, 50 people working. There are about 350 people total working on the project. And some of our subcontractors are working from 4 o'clock in the afternoon until 1 o'clock in the morning.
Fast track construction requires that much of the work be done off-site. And dozens of Utah companies pull out the stops to provide critical materials. Laid end-to-end, these concrete bleacher units would extend 8 miles. Precasting bleachers instead of pouring them on site cuts 1 year off construction time. A 500,000 lightweight masonry blocks are produced. The maze of electrical components are prefabricated to plug in when the building is finally available for electrical work. Hundreds of doors and door frames and thousands of pieces of hardware are prepared for installation. Then, of course, the showcase construction of the project, the roof.
First one like this in the USA, they tell me.
The new roof technology, used for the first time in this country, amounts to a dozen huge trusses, each strengthened by an adjustable high-tension cable running through the bottom beam. It allows for an incredible span that, if laid end-to-end, could rest on the goalpost of a football field. That is, if it didn't weigh 92 tons. The Japanese who developed the technology call it Super Wing.
You know, this is the big wing, right? So that's why we call it the Super Wing.
The truss sections are fabricated at a nearby plant, hauled to the site, bolted together, and then hoisted by two super cranes. The cranes themselves rest on a series of 9 concrete shafts planted 35 feet into the ground. Day one of the roof raising falls under the anxious eye of the owner, among others.
It's just such a big equipment, and that we've never seen such big things around here, so it's really interesting.
He likes machinery, and so it's fun for him to watch what they're doing, and we heard the trusses were going up, so that's why we're out here.
One by one, the trusses are hoisted onto the end of the building, attached to the others, then slid inch by inch along the arena frame by powerful jacks. The unique suspension system allows work below to continue unobstructed. And true to what has become standard with this project, the job of putting up the trusses is finished far ahead of schedule.
Even though that by itself certainly doesn't finish the job, it represents the completion of the final major step that we were worried about, whether or not we could get all the trusses up there on time. And I guess it's kind of the end of an era, even though it was a short era on the job. These guys have been going at it for just 4 weeks and a day. They were supposed to take 12 weeks and did it in 29 days.
It's a very exciting day for us. I mean, I was here when Sam Battistone moved the team here, when Larry became his partner, when Larry took over, when Larry said we're going to build a building, and everyone said it couldn't be done. I'm so happy for both Larry and and Salt Lake City. It's just terrific. And for the league itself, it's great.
In the shadow of the super trusses, less celebrated but equally critical work continues. Regardless of the task, most anyone will tell you that working here is more than a job. It has to be. The completion deadline is just 5 months away.
We can't have a rounded edge here. It's got to be a quarter to a half an inch down.
It is a big pour. It's a specialized pour. And that's why you see so many people out there. We can't afford any mistakes.
It's got everything that they're going to want, and it's set for basketball. Of course, this is a basketball town, and we're really happy about having it.
But there have been lots of nights when I've stayed awake worrying about how we're going to do something, trying to sort through problems.
I think everybody in this trade particularly has a lot of pride in everything that they build, and particularly this, because it is state-of-the-art, and we've made a statement on how fast one of these can be built.
Will it spoil a basketball fan?
Absolutely.
We knew that there would be good days and bad days, as there is in any project this size and as there is in life. And we're here today to announce a very good day. We are here to announce that this building will be called the Delta Center.
In the few remaining weeks of construction, the arena's unique qualities become evident. The Delta Center is built primarily for basketball, secondarily for hockey. In every other NBA arena, the reverse is true. The sight line from every seat in the Delta Center gravitates to the near basket. By superimposing the new arena seating layout over that of the Salt Palace, the improvements for all 20,000 seats become obvious. At the same time, the center is ideal for a variety of special events.
There's many type of events that Salt Lake hasn't had before that we think can enrich the lives of our people in our community educationally, certainly culturally. It's our goal to try to have people of all walks of life have an experience here.
Clearly, each experience will be enhanced by the most compelling aspect of the arena. over 3,000 panes of glass preserve the natural space and light that no degree of opulence can duplicate.
The building, as I see it, is like a lantern, a large lantern on the plaza. And you can see into it, you can see out of it. To be able to see into the building gives it a sense of activity and animation, and may even say to a person driving by or walking by, I wish I was in there. I wish I could go in and partake of that activity.
If the building is a lantern from without, it is from within a lens through which we see the city, both its triumphs and troubles, from a new perspective. The experience here gives us confidence that the challenges of greater consequence can be met. For this marvelous structure, completed on time, in record time, is not about a triumph of technology. It is about vision and drive, about the partnership and pride of community and business. It is about the tired bones, aching backs, and the scarred hands that come only by engaging the extra mile. It is a tribute to the builders.
All are architects of fate, working in these walls of time. Some with massive deeds and great, some with ornaments of rhyme. Nothing useless is or low. Each thing in its place is best, and what seems but idle show strengthens and supports the rest. For the structure that we raise, time is with materials filled. Our todays and yesterdays are block with which we build. Build today, then strong and sure, with a firm and ample base, and ascending and secure, shall tomorrow find its place. Thus alone can we attain to those turrets, where the eye sees the world as one vast plain and one boundless reach of skies.